Well, on to our big debate today. We've had a lot of you call us over the last couple of weeks and talk about prices of real estate. The general feeling around most of our big cities is that real estate is prohibitively expensive. It's so expensive that you feel you just can't afford it. There must be something going wrong in our cities if you and I and most of the other citizens believe they cannot afford the property that they actually want to buy, feel that they have to travel too far away to actually buy property they can afford. What's going wrong? Why is property so expensive? We're going to try and find out the reason why you and I cannot access the homes that we want to access. We also found out there is a possibility the real estate industry might be left out of the GST. How will that impact the prices of your homes? Is the government going in the right direction to make real estate more affordable? We're going to answer all of those questions today on Property Guide. And before I introduce my guests, I am going to throw the phone lines open. On your screen right now is a phone line. You can pick up the phone and call us if you feel that property is too expensive, if you have something to add to that conversation, or if you have a question to ask any of us. Pick up the phone and call us right now. We have a whole list of experts to answer questions today. Om Ahuja, representing the real estate industry, is the CEO of Residential at Brigade Group, joins us from Bangalore. Sunil Agarwal, Associate Dean and Director at RICS, also joins us from Bangalore. Vivek Mishra is the leader at indirect tax at PWC, brings in the tax angle. Arvind Nandan, Executive Director at Liases Foras, is an analyst in the real estate industry. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us. Of course, this is the big question. Why is real estate so expensive? I want to come first to Vivek Mishra. Vivek, is it true that real estate might actually be left out of GST entirely? And if that does happen, if that's a possibility, will it make my home even more expensive?
So there are two parts to the question, actually, from a tax perspective. One is that what do we mean when we say real estate will not be in GST? What is meant is that buying and selling a flat or an office or a plot of land will not attract GST. And so it will be outside of GST. Whether your flat will be more expensive depends on the rates that finally get implemented in the Act in terms of the construction project, what in tax terms is referred to as a works contract. So it's really a rate play. If the rates are 18%, it might be marginally more expensive. I'm just going through, skipping over a whole lot of technicalities.
But tell me this, so obviously right now we only pay service tax on property that's under construction. Will we have to continue to pay service tax, or will we pay GST then on property that's under construction? How will that work?
So currently you pay both VAT and service tax on the material portion and on the service portion respectively. Tomorrow under GST, you will pay GST, which will consist of state GST and central GST or CGST. So, the taxable base will remain unchanged.
All right, I want to bring in Om Ahuja here. Om, obviously, I mean, Bangalore tends to be a city that has a wide range of property, but if we look at the NCR region, if we look at Mumbai, and some of the key locations in Bangalore that seems to have run up a fair amount, it does feel rather unaffordable. And we've had industry turn around and tell us it's because 30% of everything you pay for property gets actually used up in taxes. Is that true? Is it the taxes that's causing realty to be that expensive? Or has industry just, you know, drummed up prices to a point where none of us can afford it?
Well, I would say, Faye, let me break this question into three parts. One, primarily keeping Bangalore in mind, it's still a city where you get an apartment ranging from 4,000 rupees per square feet to 8,000 rupees per square feet from an A-grade developer. Unlike any other city, A-grade city in India, where it's very difficult to get a product like this from an A-grade developer. That's the first part of in terms of pricing in Bangalore. Second part of this is substantial amount of money goes into taxes today with regard to service tax and VAT. Yes, that's what was not there a few years back. With government is primarily charging real estate with heavy taxes, that's end of the day being paid by a consumer, home buyer directly. The third part of this is keeping real estate out of GST bill is not a good thing. And as an industry, we are basically hoping that this will be kept in mind before they do this, because reason being, there will be further cost rise if the GST is not made part of the real estate GST bill, if real estate is not made part of the GST bill. For simple reason that we today as developers, we get input credit for the service tax and VAT we pay for goods we buy to construct. And if this basically is excluded part of the GST bill, we have no clarity at this point of time in terms of that input credit which we currently avail will have to will eventually increase the cost if in case GST is kept out of the real estate is kept out of the GST bill. That's the challenge which I am worried. If in case this is done, the real estate cost will actually go up.
By how much will it go up, Om? If you actually consider this possibility that real estate is left out of GST, by how much would an average, say, 70 lakh rupee home be increased by?
Well, I think it's very difficult to give you, Faye, at this point of time, but you know what exactly will be the cost impact. But roughly what happens is, as every developer takes the input credit, when we basically manufacture something, whatever we buy, the goods we buy for constructing, the input credit what we take at this point of time, when we pay to a vendor to buy cement, when we pay to a vendor to buy anything which we basically to construct, that credit what we get today and we adjust towards the cost, today will be additional cost if in case real estate is kept out of GST bill. That exact amount of what burden will actually be further passed on to home buyer is something which is very difficult to arrive. But yes, it will be somewhere ranging between half of what consumer currently pays and half of what we get in terms of credit. I would not be giving exact numbers, but it's a ballpark number.
Vivek Mishra, do you agree? Om seems to think that if real estate is left out of GST, we will actually be paying more for our homes because there is an added cost there that will be passed on to consumers. Is that a possibility? Are we looking at a market with actually more expensive real estate than we're already seeing right now?
So let me clarify the point about getting input credit that will continue under GST. It is real estate that will be that is expected to be out of GST, not construction. Construction is an activity. So this is a tax technical issue. So currently, the total tax burden due to VAT and service tax is approximately 13% or 14%. And then added to that is a stamp duty, which is 10%, typically 10%. So we're looking at a total tax burden of something like 24% currently. The stamp duty is going to remain unchanged. The tax credits, etc., are going to remain unchanged. In fact, they're going to be simplified and broadened. But the tax rate, as announced just on Friday, is likely to be 18%. So, as against 13 or 14% currently, it could go up to 18%, unless the government gives the sector some relief. The last point I want to make is that I just talked about construction. So what do we mean when we say that real estate will be out of the GST net? What we mean is that when a business buys an office, for example, it will not get a GST credit to offset against its other business income. When a factory is constructed, the immobile property will not generate a GST credit. That's what is meant by saying that real estate is outside the GST net.
Everything you just told us, Vivek, I'm looking at the list. Now, if we're talking about real estate in this country, obviously there's capital gains tax that we have to pay, that's indirect taxes. There's stamp duty, registration, transfer tax, municipal tax, dividend distribution tax, professional tax, excise duty, value-added tax, service tax. All of these things add up, from what I understand, somewhere in the ballpark of 30%. Is that what is making real estate expensive right now? When you look at, you know, compare it to other industries, is real estate being overtaxed?
So, India is an economy which has a lot of exemptions. So, the sectors which are taxed have to bear a very high proportion of the tax base, the tax revenues on a relatively narrow base. So real estate is no exception. The total tax burden due to excise duty, service tax, and VAT and central sales tax (CST) is about 13-14%. There are some differences in how you calculate it. Then you add to that stamp duty. So that comes to about 10% more. So we're looking at 24% or so. That's a very high tax burden.
24%, or of course, we're not counting the municipal taxes and the other things that we have to pay. Sunil Agarwal, you want to join in? Come in. Answer this simple question. I'm asking you this as a home buyer who wants to own a home in a city. What is making real estate this expensive? And let's agree it is expensive. We live in a city where most of us cannot afford to buy homes that we want to live in. What's going on?
I think there are multiple issues. One is that our cities are expanding and there is no infrastructure which has been laid in these cities. So unfortunately, your radius of cities is best 50 kilometers, whereas you go into international cities, they've expanded far more. And you go to a city like San Jose or any other city, the radius of the city is 150 kilometers, which means that there is far more land available and there is infrastructure which can take people into city centers to work and take out. So that's one. The other thing is that I, you know, don't agree that real estate is like any other sector which is taxed. Typically, if you look at real estate, we are a immovable asset category. And immovable assets globally are taxed on a stamp duty basis. So why should there be a GST or a service tax which is being laid on real estate? So I think the demand from the industry is that you should actually remove a service tax or GST altogether, because I mean, as real estate, why should a buyer pay a service tax? And yes, I mean, there is a service tax abatement of 70%, but still adds up to 3 or 4%. And now with 14%, it does add to about 4% cost. Two, when we say GST, most of the developers claim a benefit under the composite scheme because it is very difficult to live with a myriad number of GST benefits or, you know, every input. There are some 200 elements that go into real estate. So everything is taxed on a composite scheme. And that set off should be available to the developer. It is very difficult otherwise for a developer to sustain costs. So I think the incidence of tax in most of the cases will be another 5-6% if the entire GST is levied on the buyer. Currently, most of the states are not levying a sales tax. I think Maharashtra is levying some 1% or 2%. So definitely real estate, you know, one is that if it is bought under GST, obviously there will be a, you know, abatement that the developer is going to get, amortization. But my fundamental question is, why bring real estate buyer? Construction benefit should be given to the developer, but why should a buyer pay service tax? Why should a buyer pay any other form of tax? Even the leasing in this country, a landlord, when it leases a space, has a service tax incidence. We are only one of the 15 countries globally that is a tax on leasing. So I think these taxes should go away. It's been the demand of the industry for 10 years.
In fact, you know, this is the most ridiculous thing to me. When someone buys a home under construction, it's simply because they do not have the cash in hand to buy something that's ready to occupy. No home buyer will buy a home that's under construction if they can afford a home that's ready to occupy. And here is the government not taxing ready to occupy, taxing under construction. It's absolutely ridiculous. Vivek Mishra, is there any sort of move within the government right now to reconsider the possibility of taxing homes under construction?
No, I don't think so. There's a history of litigation that's behind this, but in the draft GST bill, homes under construction are taxed. And to answer your question, why are they taxed and why are when ready-to-occupy homes aren't, the answer is that all homes are taxed while they're under construction, and then in the second, third sale, etc., they're not subject to GST or to service tax or VAT once more.
All right, Arvind Nandan, come in here. What is your you know, understanding of the situation right now of why homes are so expensive in our cities? Do you also agree that it just boils down to the amount of taxation we pay, or do you think there's some sort of room here for a haircut from the builder's point of view when it comes to prices?
No, I think you know, we are discussing two very separate issues. And on the first issue, which we've discussed so far, which is the GST, I completely agree with what Vivek is saying. There is no single motherhood term called taxing a GST on real estate. There is a land component, there is a construction, and there is a service component, material and service component. So, you know, the key issue here is taxes, which is VAT and service tax, are levied on materials and the services part. The land part, which is, to be restricted by sin VAT, is not yet addressed. And it is actually completely dependent on how you value land, which is about 40% in a new project. Mm-hmm. That is number one. Number two is, we cannot really look at whether leasing is taxed or not taxed and whether this component will be benefited or not benefited. I think the simple cutoff is based on the mathematics which Vivek said, gave very clearly, is if the GST rate available for services and materials happens to be about 15% or lower, then there is a benefit in terms of the overall pricing. Otherwise, the prices just shoot up because the restrictive sen VAT on land is still not known. Mm. Now, come to the second part of the question, which is why are the prices shooting up? And they're shooting up all the time. I think we have to go into the fundamentals. Taxes or, demand supply in equilibrium or other things may be a reason, may be add-ons. But, the fundamental reason why it's happening is that we are pressure cooking real estate in these big cities. We're just pressure cooking them in terms of extra densities that we've loaded and the inadequate infrastructure, which I think Sunil mentioned. But the first and the foremost point is that real estate in these cities is overheating just because it's been overloaded with densities. And unless you have a way to disperse those densities, real estate prices cannot come down because, the more the densities, the higher the demand, and the pressure on prices will just keep going up and up. So I think the fundamental point is there. Unless you disperse the population, unless you create more avenues for people to settle and to move out or to move into other cities, this will not get tackled despite, even if you made real estate taxation near zero, or even if you did certain other things, it will have only a limited impact.
This is the conversation we're having today. We're talking about unaffordable real estate. The fact that you and I cannot afford the homes that we would actually like to buy, that we have to travel for over an hour in most of our cities to reach homes that we actually can afford. What's going wrong? Where is the big mismatch? We were talking about tax before we went into break. The fact that taxation adds up to about 30% of the pricing that we pay for real estate. And perhaps that's one of the reasons why it's so expensive. Phone lines are open if you want to join this conversation. As a home buyer, pick up the phone and call us. Any of the cities that you live in, if you feel real estate is unaffordable, be part of this conversation. Sunil Agarwal, I want to come to you here. There is, of course, a view from everyone, including the governor of the RBI, who said that builders should, in fact, start bringing down prices if they expect this market to recover. I know it is a view that a lot of our viewers also share. Do you agree that there's room for a haircut on prices?
There are several parts to this, and I think I've worn a hat of a developer.
I would rather appreciate a yes or no instead of you breaking it down. Do you think there's room for lower prices or no?
Not in the affordable category of housing.
What about the rest of it? What about the middle income? What about the luxury housing that's not selling right now? Is there room for prices to come down?
I think there is a pricing which has already come down by 30% in most of the cities.
When you say pricing has come down by 30% in most of the cities, you'll have to qualify that. It hasn't come down where I live,
luxury
and I live
housing.
In the city of Mumbai. Where has
luxury
pricing come down 30%?
Can I give you
No. In the luxury segment, if you see across the board, in Delhi, most of the floors are down by 30%. Okay. Even in the housing, which is so-called luxury housing in Mumbai, if you go and negotiate with the developer, I think prices are off 15-20%. So I think there's no right or wrong answer. Real estate is very dispersed, and if you try and paint it with one brush, I don't think so you're doing justice. So I think when a governor of RBI wants to let the housing pricing come down, I think governor of RBI should say that the very first house that somebody buys, he buys after paying income tax. Why is somebody trying to buy the first house of his marginal income? I mean, that's the first relief that the governor should talk about. So I think when people look at real estate,
I actually wanted to say there is a straight answer to this. The prices need to come down, yes.
Right.
But the onus of bringing the pricing down does not lie entirely with the developer. So if we actually fix the responsibility on developer alone, it's not going to work and we will have only more and more pain. There are several other constituents or ingredients in the whole system, and they all need to work in tandem.
All right, we have a viewer on the line. Rahul has called us. Rahul, Thank you for calling. Tell us what you think. Are you able to afford the home that you would like to buy? Why not?
No, so that's what I had called in regarding. So I'm watching your discussions regularly. So I'm basically an IT employee and I'm looking to buy a house in Bombay. Mm-hmm. I'm not from here, but I'm from Bangalore. So looking at the situation right now, looking at the prices and looking at the rates that are going, I is it possible for somebody in my salary bracket to buy a house, or should he just go and rent it?
Actually, you know, that's a very fair argument, because given the market that we're looking at right now, I mean, I would rather just rent a home. Om Ahuja, if I can't afford to buy realty, then I can just live on rent for the rest of my life, because that's where a lot of professionals have been shoved to the corner. Yeah, we're emotionally attached to the idea of owning our own home, but if you can't afford it, you can't afford it. And the market is, quite frankly, unaffordable.
Well, I would agree with you, Faye. The cities like Mumbai and Delhi have become unaffordable. Absolutely agree with Rahul, who finds Bombay good for, you know, taking a home on lease and basically live there rather than buying a home. Because every component in Bombay, the kind of loading what you see, the carpet to built up loading, which is basically almost 55-60% in Bombay, it makes completely life very, very complicated. Whereas in other cities than Bombay and Delhi, where the loading is quite reasonable in terms of not more than 20-25%. The prices are still affordable. There's a lot more life moving out of these two cities to basically ensure that quality of life is better and the affordability is still there. I'm not just referring to Bangalore, but I'm referring to Hyderabad, referring to Chennai, referring to Pune. There are cities which are doing affordable and they are much more livable compared to Bombay and Delhi.
Vivek Mishra, I'm going to bring you in here on a slightly personal question. How old were you when you bought your first home? And did you feel that, you know, it could have actually been more affordable?
So everything to do with real estate is more expensive than it should be. How old was I? I had a home constructed. The construction finished when I was about 35 or so. I think there are various problems that have been mentioned by the other panelists. There are two problems which they have not covered as yet. One is time. It takes very long to get anything done in India because of, apart from many other things, the permits, the sanctions, etc. that you need. So all that adds up to time, which adds to cost. The second issue which was mentioned was infrastructure. I want to expand on that just for half a minute. The infrastructure, such as it is concentrated in the center of cities. So there is more scarcity of land created by the lack of infrastructure, and that drives up prices as well. So it's not only the tax system, but of course the tax system is also extremely high.
Rahul, I'm going to bring Rahul back in here if he's still on the phone line. Rahul, are you satisfied with those answers? The fact that you and I can't afford homes in the city of Mumbai because there isn't enough infrastructure, the taxes are too high, the government doesn't seem to, you know, be doing its job really in order to make homes more accessible.
So it's not satisfactory, I would say, but then the thing is, I mean, people like me, we are working in Bombay. We're not from here. We come from different towns and we come here for work. So for us, it is imperative that we buy a house here. People who are staying here, they've bought houses years back, and that's why they got those houses for cheap. Right now, it's just completely impossible to buy these rates. So that's what I'm thinking. So maybe the future for me is to rent a house here while I'm staying here, or maybe like buy a home in Bangalore, in my hometown.
Buy a home in Bangalore, in your hometown. I see Om Ahuja is smiling all the way from Bangalore. That answer worked out just fine for him. Arvind Nandan, what can people like Rahul do right now? What's the advice you'd give someone like Rahul?
Well, you know, the first thing is, I don't know Rahul's salary, but I'm guessing, you know, it'll allow him about 60, 70, 80 lakhs worth of purchase. The problem is, you know, the urban sweet spot these days is about 40 to 50 lakhs. The land pricing and the other costs have made it so unviable to construct houses and sell them at 40-50 lakhs that everything is at least double the sweet spot. Now, when you have double the sweet spot, you really can't afford it. So the best solution is only to go ahead and rent. Having said that, I'll stress another point which Om had actually said earlier. Bangalore is one of those places where you still can buy 50, 60 lakh kind of ticket size houses. So are certain other places. But if you are in the main heartland of Mumbai or in Delhi, it's practically impossible. So it's best to actually rent and you know, look at those places where you can afford 50, 60, 70 lakh kind of ticket sizes.
You know, for someone like Rahul, who's you know, salaried, I'll bring Vivek in here. Vivek, I want to push you a little bit into direct taxes. This actually works out interestingly because if he's salaried, he'll claim HRA on the rent he's paying, and he'll claim the home loan deductions on both interest and you know, the principal repayment, which means that he'll get a double taxation benefit from renting in Mumbai and buying in Bangalore. Doesn't that work out better?
Yeah, but so from a tax point of view, he ends up paying for the rent and for some of the home service, the loan servicing out of his pre-tax income. But from a cash flow point of view, I mean, as long as he's paying that loan and as long as he's paying rent, that's a heavy cash flow burden.
That's true, that is a heavy cash flow burden. Om, you wanted to add something? Om, come in.
Yeah, I would say, you know, buying a home in Bangalore and servicing a rent in Bombay will give dual tax benefit. Correct me, Vivek, if I'm wrong. Primarily give him the benefit of paying the loan EMI here and they claim the tax benefit for it, and also service a loan there. Paying the EMIs there will give him, paying the rent there will give him HRA benefit in terms of adjustment. Above all, it makes a lot of simple life for him to take the capital appreciation benefit in Bangalore rather than basically looking at capital appreciation in Bombay city, where there is capital appreciation looks to be very bleak at this point of time.
That's an interesting you know, angle to bring all of it into it. The fact that even though Mumbai seems to be the most exciting market right now. I want Arvind and Sunil to come in on this. Om saying that there's no capital appreciation that you can expect from the city of Mumbai. Do either of you agree with that?
Well, I think there is certain truth
in
that.
It's
incorrect saying that there is absolutely no capital appreciation. Actually, there could be, given the pockets that you choose. So I don't say it applies to the whole of Mumbai as such, but yes, to certain pockets it does. At the same time, it's true that most or the majority of pockets in Bangalore city will give you maybe some, if not, you know, a substantial capital appreciation.
That's a really vague answer. What do you mean by some?
So I would say, you know, on a year-on-year basis, in the next 4 to 5 years, you can still earn about 10-15% or so. Mm-hmm. But you have to be able to have that horizon. If you are looking to gain on capital appreciation in 2 years, then probably you may not get anything. If you stay on for long, which is about 5, 6, 7, 8 years, then you probably do. In Mumbai, it's far more bleak at the moment, I do agree. But it doesn't apply to the whole city as such in one go.
Sunil Agarwal?
Yeah, I think I agree with Arvind, because real estate cannot be, as I said earlier, also painted with one brush. The only other thing that I'll mention is that if you look at this whole double tax benefit, it works to a price point of 30, 40 lakhs. If you go for a house purchase which is more than that, the tax benefit is not as high. And, you know, that is why, again, the affordable housing becomes very, very sweet at 30, 40 lakhs a spot. The other issue that I also want to bring here is that your houses are expensive in the city because there is a land acquisition, development and disposal process, which if you look at DDA or you look at some of these development authorities, they take years to acquire land and then put infrastructure and then sell. So I think at the end of the day, you know, it's a combination of governments. It's also a combination of infrastructure, taxation, everything. And real estate, unfortunately, not brought out in this debate, is being looked at a variety of sections of milch cow. So, you know, as a sector, I think I would bat for no taxation to the buyer for service tax or GST. It was not there in India. It was introduced by Mr. Chidambaram, I think, 10 years ago. And we should revert back to that system. And that will ease at least 3 or 4 or 5%. And obviously, infrastructure is the crying need of the hour.
All right, we have another viewer on the phone right now. Arup Ganguly, I believe, is on the phone line with us from Mumbai. Arup, good evening. Thank you for calling us. Tell us, do you find property in Mumbai unaffordable right now? And why do you think that is?
Hello.
Arup, yeah, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Yeah, I had a question and I just wanted to ask. I've been hearing about the GST and I was planning to buy a flat in Thane.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to inquire whether I should hold off for a while and await the GST so that I can get some benefits. And that was my question to your panel.
All right, Vivek Mishra, come in here. This is an interesting question. For anybody looking to buy a house right now, we know it's a six-month process to actually close on a home, get the home loan done, and actually, you know, sign on the dotted line. So for someone who's looking to buy a house at this point, like Arup, who just called us, should they be waiting for some clarity on GST? Or if you think it's going to become more expensive, like most of our panelists agree, should they actually close that deal right now?
No, I don't think they should be looking for more clarity because so it's not going to happen in 1 week or in a month that there will be more clarity. So they should just go ahead. In terms of whether the whether housing becomes more expensive, primarily depends on whether the 18% rate will apply on housing. If the government sees that there is a heavier burden on this, and I think the government is reasonably sensitive to this sector, the government can provide relief. So I'm still hopeful that the burden will remain as is, although I'm not very hopeful that it will reduce.
All right, Arvind Nandan, answer that question from a real estate point of view. If he's looking to buy a home in Thane at this point, should he just go ahead and, you know, find a home, close the deal, not worry about the taxation angle at all?
Absolutely. I don't think there's any doubt about that. If you have found something which fits in your budget, which meets your other requirements, just go ahead and close it. Because you can never actually keep, you know, hoping for something else in future. You never know how things pan out. So if you have found something which fits your needs, just go ahead and close it, I think.
All right. I'm going to ask all of our guests for closing remarks before we wrap up this discussion. The fact that real estate is expensive at this point, and it might not be something that we leave at the door of the developer because the government has a certain amount of responsibility to take up in terms of taxation and the lack of infrastructure in our cities. If we had to change one thing in our market at this point to make real estate more affordable, what would that be? Sunil Agarwal, you go first.
I think it is the high-speed transportation corridors which will take in and take out people quickly from cities, so that infrastructure is very, very critical to solving the issue of expensive real estate.
Vivek Mishra, what can we do to make real estate and homes more affordable?
I think all the things that are required for the economy at large, better infrastructure, better speed of decision making, more transparency, everything will help lower the cost of infrastructure, will lower the cost of housing. But all of these solutions are needed for the economy anyway.
Arvind Nandan?
I think you have to do two things. In the short term, you have to somehow increase the the moving infrastructure capacity. But in the longer term, that will not help as well. You have to disperse these cities. You have to set up new urban centers. Otherwise, people will just keep living in these.
I have a rebut to all of this. We need high-speed infrastructure. Every time we've seen a metro line go anywhere in any city, the real estate prices almost are driven up at the very announcement of the metro line. So the fact is that wherever that high-speed, you know, rail or connectivity or mass transport goes, the prices go up with it. So how are we going to see affordability at all?
That's where the answer is, Faye. You know, unless we disperse the cities, unless you move out economic centers out of the cities, there's no point having one BKC and connecting it with 100 kilometers away. You have to move another, you have to put up another BKC so that you don't have a reliance on one BKC in Mumbai or you don't have reliance on one Gurgaon in NCR. Unless you move economic centers and disperse people, disperse population, disperse demography, it's not going to work.
But, you know, we've had a lot of these conversations. Since you brought up BKC, we've had conversations with the municipal commissioners of Kalyan, Dombivli and Thane. They're talking about peripheral business neighborhoods. But can those neighborhoods actually support what BKC does in terms of social infrastructure, in terms of, you know, being so close to the city, in terms of having all of the, you know, the infrastructure that it has right now? Can a Kalyan Dombivli ever be a Bandra Kurla complex?
You have to move economic centers. It's not about moving houses. You know, the history tells us that just building houses does not solve problems. You have to move economic centers. You have to put places of work. You have to put economic activities there.
Sunil Agarwal, come in. What did you have to add?
Now, I think there are lessons that we learn in metro stations. There were a lot of malls and commercial spaces planned in Delhi. Only one is successful. So I don't think so. It's a paint of brush that every real estate becomes expensive too. If you look at New York, there's a lot of space which is there right in the Manhattan area. And that space is cheaper than what you have in BKC because there's such a lot of it. So I think you do have a facilitation in decreasing real estate prices. You have real estate which is cheaper in San Jose. But in India, I agree with Arvind that, you know, metros have not started to connect the peripheries of the city. If they started to do that, you will see the price will come down in the city center. That's the global norm, and it's not going to be different in India.
Om Ahuja, do you also agree that it's simply about infrastructure at this point?
Well, there are quite many more things at this point of time rather than just saying infrastructure. The Bombay city has its own challenges in terms of creating that infrastructure, whereas in city like Bangalore and city like Hyderabad and Chennai specifically, there's a lot of work happening on the metro connectivity and a lot of peripheral roads, ring roads and many other aspects being considered into. There's a lot more planning happening when you compare it to Mumbai. Yes, we would say that there Delhi has a lot of planning happening, but Delhi has its own challenges with regard to Delhi NCR being a large region. It has its own challenges with job creation in Bangalore specifically. Even having Whitefield, Outer Ring Road, Sajapur Road, or primarily Yeshwantpur, Rajaji Nagar, where we have a large commercial World Trade Center, which is doing extremely well, which has created its own livelihood, and it has created neighborhood in terms of people living and working here. This is something which is very unique. Without having infrastructure in place, we could create that in one part of the city.
All right, we're going to have to take
and,
a very quick...
That if I support that argument, specifically in Mumbai...
Go ahead, Om. Go ahead.
No, I was saying in case of Mumbai, creating Dombivli or creating Thane, as rightly said by Sunil, one needs to see whether the cost of infrastructure which is being created, cost of offices, leasing an office, making a life simple and affordable there, is something going to be really possible or not possible. At this point of time, if Thane is quoting maybe 50% or 40% premium to Bangalore's real estate price, I'm not sure whether Thane is going to command that kind of jobs what Bangalore is creating.
That's where it's not just about infrastructure,
yeah.
It's about moving economic centers. It's
so
not
what
just
do you
about
mean when you say moving economic centers if it's not about infrastructure?
The places of work, the activities where the economic activities take place. You have to create
yeah,
those Arvind, places.
Why will I move my business to Thane?
You don't
to Thane
move,
if,
you create another one. The problem is today we load everything in 10-kilometer radius.
This is also the problem we saw in the south, for example, and Om's talking to us from Bangalore right now. There was a time when Infosys and Wipro and all of the other IT guys decided to try Mysore, they decided to try Mangalore, but everybody wanted to come back and live in Bangalore.
I can't imagine
people who walk to work in BKC will ever want to live in Thane.
No, it's not about creating a city another 100, 200 kilometers away. It's about dispersing the economic activities within that city's periphery.
So I still don't understand what you mean by dispersing economic
activities. Whitefield.
Okay.
You have a Manyata in the north. Hmm. You have three or four equally strong economic hubs which create their own fulcrums.
All
and
in
around
Bangalore,
which,
all yeah. causing traffic jams in and around them.
No, we are not discussing traffic jams.
It's a completely different argument you are having here.
No. So traffic jams are not happening because these are different centers.
Traffic jams are happening because the infrastructure hasn't been managed.
But why are prices still in the range of 5,000 to 6,000 rupees in Bangalore? It's because you don't load everything, don't pressure cook everything in one place. And that's what I'm saying. You know, if you have everything to load in lower
Since we're talking
or in
about
BKC,
Bangalore, are you not happen. Pressure cooking property in Bangalore? Yeah.
Faye, let me share with you. If in case you are working in World Trade Center, Rajaji Nagar in Bangalore, you can afford to buy a house close to Rajaji Nagar. If you are working in Whitefield, you can afford to buy a house in Whitefield, unlike Mumbai, where you basically create your own house. And after that, if you change your job, it's very difficult for you to go to, let's say, for example, you're working in Andheri and you want to relocate to Bandra or you want to relocate to BKC. You cannot even dream of buying a house in BKC. And forget about BKC. It's today Thane, which is again, I'm reiterating this, that Thane today is quoting at 40% premium to Bangalore, any part of Bangalore. Whitefield, which is creating so many jobs today, Whitefield, Thane quotes twice the price of Whitefield.
Right.
I'm not sure whether affordability
it seems like
by
the conversation
moving just
is moving
fulcrum to Thane
you know,
or Dombivli will really help.
Yeah, that Bombay or Mumbai, the Mumbai market, whether Thane or anywhere else in this, in the MMR region, is just not the market to be in right now. But we should actually be considering other markets, like maybe Bangalore or Pune. Sunil Agarwal, you had something to add. Come in here. Is the Mumbai market overpriced to a point where I can no longer expect any sort of appreciation?
I think there's no question that Mumbai market is overpriced. I think there is one silver lining that in India, your rentals are 1% or 2%, not more than that in residential space. So I think for cities like Bombay, the earlier caller said, I want to just rent it. I think that's the dictum that's going to have. So, you know, fools are going to buy houses, or people who want to invest for a long term may want to buy houses. But in city centers, it's easier to lease and, you know, live with that money and enjoy it. If I want to buy a 20 crore apartment, why can't I rent a lakh of rupees or 2 lakh rupees of apartment and live with the other 18 lakhs and, you know, really have a nice life? So I think it makes really no sense, if you really think from a pure economic perspective, to buy a house in Bombay city center and, why not just lease off it?
All right, we have another phone. We have another viewer on the phone line right now. I believe Arjun has called us. Arjun, go ahead. What would you like to add?
Yeah, hi. I'm calling from Bangalore.
Mm-hmm.
And I've just started working. And what I wanted to ask was, since government has been pushing for the affordable housing, shall I wait for another 4 years to buy a house, or like shall I invest right now?
You wait for another 4 years to buy a house, or should you invest right now? Are you looking for an investment, Arjun, or are you actually looking for a home to live in Bangalore?
No, I'm actually looking for a home to live in Bangalore since I've been working here.
Okay, Om, do you want to answer that? Here's a young man who's just begun working in Bangalore. He's obviously an out-of-towner. He's asking you simply this.
Sure, I think... Certainly. Arjun, I think if it's a need for staying, unlike as other panelists said, the rentals in rental yield in Bombay or Delhi is 1-2%. Unlike those cities, Bangalore has a rental yield of 3-4%. So when you compare it to basically buying your own house in Bangalore city, where we see the prices are still affordable and prices are still not gone through the roof, and with this kind of demand which is generating in Bangalore, number of jobs which are getting generated in Bangalore, very soon we may have very difficulty in finding the land in Bangalore. And maybe 3-4 years down the road, it will be very difficult to find the land in Whitefield to build a home. So I'm sure that the prices, it's a demand supply end of the day. 4 years down the road, the prices may move up. So it's better to catch the prices what they are currently, and specifically when you are looking at rental yield versus the EMI you pay. So I think it makes a lot of economic sense for you to look at buying a house now if it's for self-use.
All right, Arjun, does that satisfy you as a, you know, do you have the answer to your question? Go ahead and buy now. But see, my question to you, Arjun, is this. Do you find homes in Bangalore affordable? Have you found something that fits in your budget at this point?
I have been looking around, and the property rates have been mostly around 4,000 to 8,000 per square feet, which I don't think is really much. But that's where my question lied exactly. Like with the affordable housing coming up, whether it was the right time to buy or shall I be waiting? So I guess I've been explained satisfactorily. So I guess I can look for investing right now, right?
All right, Arjun. Well, you know, I want to just simply consider this. The fact that we've got around in circles a couple of times and come back to the fact that Bangalore possibly has better opportunities. We know that Pune is a similar market, has similar pricing at this point. You can still find very, very affordable homes in Pune. Does that also mean that Pune, Sunil, Pune will offer me more appreciation as well?
I really don't think so, because there's more supply, and as I think the callers said, it's a demand and supply situation. So I think if some pockets in Pune have been overbuilt and there is an inventory overhang, you will not see prices move up for a significant period of time. And also, I think a lot of people make a mistake that I want to live in that house and I also want to invest. I think people have to keep these two things separately. Either you invest or you buy for living. And when you try and combine these two things, I think decisions get blurred. So Pune or Delhi is no different. I think just look at the macro market, micro market, and see what's the demand and supply, and you will get the answer.
All right, I want to bring in Vivek Mishra here. Vivek, what is your advice right now? I know you deal with indirect tax, but what is your advice right now personally as well for someone who's looking to buy a home? We had Arjun on the phone line, we had Arup on the phone line, all young men looking to own homes in the cities that they live in. What advice would you give them?
Well, my advice has got nothing to do with whether real estate is expensive or whether it will become cheaper or whatever, I think it makes more sense to rent when you're young and when your income is on its way up, because if you buy and if your you know career hopefully goes well and your income increases, then after a few years you'll be able to afford something better. So it makes more sense to rent when you're young, and also you may well have to move cities. So again, from that viewpoint, it makes more sense to rent.
Or it makes more sense to rent when you're young. Does everybody on the panel agree with that? I know Om will be a little frowny on that.
For one, I don't agree. I mean, you start to buy a house and it's like a, you know, small piggy bank. So if you can afford a 1 BHK, buy 1 BHK. If you can buy a 2 BHK, do that early in the life, because I think the cycle catches up. And in real estate, if the cycle catches up, you know, it really, really puts, you know, people out of price. You priced out. I bought a flat in Chimpun, it was 32 lakhs. Today it's 2.5 crores. I don't think so I can buy for 2.5 crores now.
How long ago was that, Sunil, when you bought a flat in Chimpun?
2004.
Vivek Mishra, had he invested the same amount of money in the stock market, he would have done a little better, wouldn't he?
Yeah, I think so.
2004 at the stock market. Sunil, if you'd put the same 32 lakh rupees, you would have paid no property tax, you would have paid no income tax on the rent. And if you're selling at this point, you won't have to pay capital gains tax either.
And so you would have had serious BP check.
Let me tell you. No. I think there is this whole debate. In 2004, when I bought the house, I paid nothing for it. I just went to the developer, I got a receipt of 4 lakhs, went to the bank for finance it, and I got a 42 lakh rupee loan. So I paid nothing for that house. And when I rented that house, my EMI was 27,000 and my rent was 30,000. So I lived on leverage and created this 2.5 crores for almost zero down payment. In fact, I had 2 lakh rupees surplus when the bank was, you know. So I think if you want to create real estate, this argument can go on. And I think, yes, capital markets do give you a lot of appreciation over a long period of time. I think you should just exit it when real estate is expensive and people just hold on to that. And I think that's where the real estate markets don't give you that kind of appreciation.
Vivek, do you have a rebut to that?
Well, actually, if you look at it in pure financial terms, it makes more sense to rent and not to buy a house at all. But that's something that emotionally most of us cannot do. So as soon as we have the money, the one thing we want is a house which we own. But the rent versus buy argument is not just in your 20s. It actually continues all through.
All right. You know, that's like the argument to invest in stocks as opposed to buying jewelry, but it's something we never buy in this country. We never actually buy into that argument. Om, you want to add to that? You said something. Go ahead.
Well, I would say, Faye, it's very, very relative. I would say if it is something to do with a city where the prices are still realistic, the appreciation is still possible, one can look at buying a house rather than taking it on lease. Whereas in cities like Mumbai, NCR, where the prices have gone through the roof and where basically appreciation is very, very minuscule in terms of that whatever will happen very little, then it makes a lot of sense to go for lease.
You know,
so
I
it's again,
go, I
would not say
you
that you can equate everything in one bucket. But
what you just told Arjun, and you said in a little while we will have no land left in Whitefield and there will be no room for us to build any houses. You painted a very Mumbai-esque picture
absolutely,
for Whitefield.
Absolutely.
So eventually...
You'll be surprised. Even today,
so dearly, will reach a point
even
where
today
it will not afford, it will not be able to offer any appreciation because it will run up so desperately.
You'll be surprised. Even today, there is a shortage. There is no land available in some parts of Bangalore, like Sajapur Road, Outer Ring Road. Lot of offices are moving towards North Bangalore. Lot of movement happening towards North Bangalore because there's no land available in that part of city. And if you look at Whitefield today, clean, clear, title land, if you want to go on a hunt, it'd be very difficult for you to get a land parcel which is a sizable land parcel. I'm not referring to 1 acre, half acre. If I'm referring to, you need at least 5-10 acres of land parcel. Very difficult to find land parcel today. I am worried 5 years down the road, what will happen if there is no supply? The prices will go up. And then the Vivek's argument of staying it on rent, 5 years later, then you'll have something like Sunil saying, I bought an apartment in Chembur and now it is almost 2.5 crores, maybe 5 times, 10 times of my return. And that's basically possible in Bangalore.
That's possible in Bangalore. Unfortunately, we're running out of time on this show. I'm going to have to thank all of the gentlemen who joined us. It's simply boiled down to this. In the city of Mumbai, prices will continue to remain high because of the fact that land is not available and infrastructure just hasn't kept up. There might be some room for appreciation in Bangalore and Pune. But remember, that appreciation means that prices will continue to increase in those cities. So those opportunities might not be available forever. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us on the Property Guide on Magicbricks Now. It's been a pleasure to have this conversation with you. Stay with the channel, of course, for more news and updates. If you'd like to log into our website, mbnow.in, we have a live stream running where you can watch this channel on your phone on the go, and you can reach us on the phone number and the email ID and send us any sort of feedback. It'll be our pleasure to hear from you. Thanks for watching.